What's the loveliest word in the English language, officer? What do you think?
That's not my bag, sir, now, is it?
Oh, now, I'll tell you. E-L-B-O-W. Elbow.
Named after a line in Dennis Potter's television series The Singing Detective, Elbow, a rock band from Bury in Lancashire. For nearly two decades, their music has been praised by artists and critics. But putting musical integrity ahead of commercial success has lost them record deals and for many years kept them on the fringes of the mainstream. In 2009, that changed.
The winner is...
Elbow!
Elbow! Elbow. Yeah! For their album, The Seldom Seen Kid.
Their fourth album, The Seldom Seen Kid, won the Mercury Music Prize, two Ivor Novellos, Brit, NME, Mojo and the South Bank Show Awards. In tonight's South Bank Show, Elbow talk about their music and play it here in Manchester.
How dare the premier ignore my invitations? He'll have to go. So to the bunch he luncheons with is second on my list of things to do. At the top is stopping by your place of work and acting like I haven't dreamed of you and I and marriage in an orange grove. You are the only thing in any room you're ever in. I'm stubborn, selfish and too old.
In Starlings, I love the crashes when they come in. But at the end, where you go to the idea of Starlings and the whole thing becomes a great soaring web of sound.
The horn blast that we decided to put at the beginning of that song are to represent love crashing in and taking you by surprise.
I sat you down and told you how the truest love that's ever found is for oneself. You pulled apart my theory with a weary and disinterested sigh. So yes, I guess I'm asking you to back a horse that's good for glue and nothing else. But find a man that's truer than, find a man that needs you more than I. Sit with me a while and let me listen to you talk about your dreams and your obsessions. I'll be quiet and confessional. Violets explode inside me when I meet your eyes. Then I'm spinning and I'm diving like a cloud of stars. Manchester is this love.
When you see them live, you know, I think they're very, very sort of earnest and real, and but also non-pretentious, you know. It's not all about posturing at all, it's all about, it's the real thing, it's what we are.
They sound so unique, and I think it is the amalgamation of the music and the musicianship. They are great musicians, and Guy's voice, and also the fact that they are defiantly northern.
So how did you kick off? Was it, I always wanted to do this, or did you stumble into it, or what happened?
Mark and Peter and Richard in the band were friends from school, primary school, in fact. I met them when I was 17, but yeah, Mark and Rick and Pete, they always wanted to be in a rock band. And yeah, Mark picked me up on the way home from sixth form college one day.
And then Losing My Religion came on the radio and he started harmonising to it. And straight away I said, you know, come to a rehearsal, do you want to join the band? And Guy says these days he'd had 100 offers to be in bands, but I was the only one that actually came round and picked him up and went to the rehearsal.
And I remember saying very confidently at the end of the first rehearsal that we'd be signed in 6 months. And that's where it began, really. We sort of... Mark in particular, the guitarist in the band, never had any doubt in his mind that we'd be a success. And I think that rubbed off on us, really, on all of us.
Despite claiming they'd be signed in 6 months, it would be 10 years before the band released an album.
Right now, it's showtime at PJ's.
So we're just approaching Apocalypse Studios, which was our rehearsal place for years and years.
Rehearsals didn't really stop. We used to hang around afterwards.
And we'd stay till sort of 5, 6 in the morning.
I don't know, write comedy songs, have a smoke.
When we first started here, we were called Soft. We were into Sly and the Family Stone, Santana, Beastie Boys, Shake Your Head.
People might think it's a bit odd that the Beastie Boys influence Elbow, but the groove's got to be bang on.
Coming up here on the left, this building here is called the Derby Hall, and that's where a lot of the first gigs were.
6 months old.
Yeah, we were kids when we were in prams together, apparently.
As a kid, I was really into heavy metal.
Adam and the Ants were the first band that I really, really loved.
Bands like Anthrax, Iron Maiden.
Then it was Duran Duran.
Proper drummers, rocking drummers, which I don't know why I ended up with these lads.
I used to make words up a lot more than I do.
Public Enemy were absolutely huge for me.
I met a bumbling, rambling, verbalite, urbanoid poet. That's just terrible, isn't it?
We thought we were going to make it there and then, right from the beginning. That's a record.
How did you go about trying to be a professional band?
The first thing that happened was we organised a few shows and we took the early shows as seriously as we take shows now, and we made sure that we had jobs that didn't interfere with our rehearsal schedule. Mm. We've always had quite a regimented rehearsal schedule. And if you were 20 minutes late, and this is when we're 18, 19, if you were 20 minutes late, there was a row, there was an argument. And no one person put that in place, that was just there from the beginning, especially as the rest of our friends had gone to university. And we'd sort of, I felt certainly, that sacrificed university to concentrate on the band, so we were going to do it seriously.
The Weather to Fly lyrics, so does that say something about that feeling at the moment?
Absolutely, yeah. Weather to Fly is perhaps the only song I've written to and for and about the band, how it feels to be with your old friends and how it felt back then. And, yeah, we had the drive and the time on our hands. And especially the bit about, it says, we'd sing in the doorways and bicker and row, figuring how we were wired inside. That's never a truer word spoken. We did so much arguing. But never a punch thrown.
Looking for a poem that I wrote about when I was 22 and living in a house in Prestwich, Mountfield. I have a drop leaf window with cats and broken yards, sunflowers and paint cans and broken shopping carts, and nothing to be proud of and nothing to regret, all of that to make as yet. And it was just about being pre-adulthood and that kind of brilliant feeling. Paul McCartney puts it much better and simply, oh, that magic feeling, nowhere to go. Sort of a piece of music can put me right back there, like Early Pumpkins or something like that.
By 1997, albums by Soundgarden, Spiritualized and Smashing Pumpkins had influenced Soft to a more rock sound. They changed their name to Elbow, hired a professional manager, Phil Chadwick, and moved 9 miles down the A56 to Manchester.
So the building on the corner there with the black doors is Manchester Roadhouse.
The whole band ended up working at the Roadhouse.
We'd all been into Siamese Dream, the album. We knew they had another album coming out. I don't remember anticipation like it. We were just could not wait to hear that album.
You know, at the time, bands that were coming through the Roadhouse were like, you know, Mogwai and Arab Strap. It was a very exciting period for us.
We used to refer to this as the office. When we moved from Bury to Manchester, we did our first shows here, and sort of pre-mobile phones, I used to sit at the end of the bar here, and I used to give out the bar number of this place as my phone number. So constantly waiting for a record company or management calls.
I haven't been myself of late. I haven't slept for several days. But coming home, I feel like I design the buildings I walk by. You know you drive me off the wall. I need to see your faces all.
Station Approach is about coming home to Manchester and the feeling of stepping off the train at Piccadilly. And that feeling that anybody has returning home, of being proud of the place and feeling at home there and feeling a part of it. And it says in the song, coming home, I feel like I design the buildings I walk by. I was trying to get that feeling into words for so long, for years, actually. I'd written it about 5 or 6 years before, but it just didn't scan, it didn't work.
I need to be in the town where they know what I'm like and don't mind. I never know what I want, but I know when I'm low that I need to be in the town where they know what I'm like and don't mind. I never know what I want, but I know when I'm low that I need to be.
There's two lines. I never know what I want, but I know when I'm low that I need to be in the town where they know what I'm like and don't mind. They're really good lines. Where'd they come from?
It was the need for the mantra. It was the need for the chant in the song.
Yeah.
We decided really early on in the writing of the song that things were going to repeat and build, and those first chords that Craig came out with, we were just going to add more instruments doing the same thing. And the rhythms that started at the beginning were just going to get bigger.
For a long time, we were playing high-tempo funk music and people would come and dance to the gigs because it was high-tempo music. All the time we were doing this, we were writing these sort of mellower, more introspective songs that we didn't have the confidence to play live because we just thought they won't go down well, people can't dance to them. And then I think one day we just decided to have the confidence in that stuff and stop playing the throwaway funky dance stuff that we were doing. And I think the first song that was ever written was Powder Blue.
Powder Blue was the first tune that we had played on the radio. And for it to be on radio with John Peel was like a massive deal. We were kind of, I think it was like around this time of In the City, and me and Guy were heading into town with our manager Phil, and we kind of jumped in his car. Phil started it up and Powder Blue was on the radio, but at this point, you know, we had like demo tapes, millions of them, and we just assumed it was one of those, and we kind of like looked down, me and Phil just glanced down at the same time, and the tape was kind of like sticking out the machine, and we looked and it was Radio One, and it was just an absolute moment.
Look
called Elbow. We're a five-piece from Buried, and Powder Blue is the first song on the Noise Box.
Your eyes are just like black spiders. Your hair and dress in ribbons. Baby cakes. Despair or incoherence. Nothing in between. China white, my bride tonight. Smiling.
You're going on for a very long time now, not succeeding in the sense. Let's call getting a deal for a first album success, which is fair enough.
Yeah.
Fair enough. You're not getting there, and yet you're pegging away. Is this? Were you kept going by the fact that you thought it was going to happen? You didn't think it's going to take 10 years, did you?
No.
It'll happen in January, or maybe March, or
it was always March, actually. Yeah. If nothing's happened by March, we used to say, I don't know why March.
Really?
Yeah. It was always, if nothing's happened by March, but by March, there'd be another gig on the horizon, or we'd have a new set of recordings we're really proud of.
We used to fool ourselves back, I don't know, 8 years into, well, we've been a band for 8 years or something. We used to sort of say maybe at New Year, or, you know, if it's not quite this time next year, if it not happened, then maybe we should think about doing something else. But we just gradually realised that we can't do anything else, and we don't want to do anything else. So, you know, I think we understood after a while that even if we never got signed, you know, we'd still do it.
At the time, even our mates weren't coming to our gigs. They were sick to death of seeing us. I remember one week playing at the Roadhouse, there were three or four people there, and I was ringing my mates up saying, you're coming down, and they were like, I'm sorry, Pot, I'm not coming.
You know, like at the end of the night, like working for, I don't know, 6-7 hours behind the bar and stuff like that, you'd be sweeping up around these bands that are sort of like having the beers and just having a laugh and, you know, getting ready to go on to the next city and stuff like that. And you could imagine that you would be quite bitter about it, you know, thinking, why aren't I doing that? Why aren't I where, you know, they are? We're much better than them. But there was this kind of like just quiet confidence I think we all had.
When we changed the name of the band to Elbow, we decided that was a last waltz. The first Elbow gig was actually potentially the last gig we were going to do. The first gig went well enough for us to enter the Inner City competition that Tony Wilson used to run. That's really where we got our first record deal.
And what was that deal?
We signed to Island Records just before it became part of Universal.
That's a bit attractive signing to Island Records at the time.
Huge for us, you know. We, most of our favourite acts were on there, Tom Waits and Bob Marley and people like that, Nick Drake. And, yeah, it was huge, but we went away and made the first record, and then because of the buyout from Universal, we lost our first record deal.
And then it was not released.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, which was quite a wrench, because most of us were claiming benefits of one kind or another. On my last benefits interview, when we got our first record deal, I really stuck it to... I really stuck it to him. And then a year later, found myself in the same benefits office, sort of after losing the deal. So that was a lesson for life.
In 2001, 10 years after they formed, Elbow released their debut album, Asleep in the Back. It was nominated for a Mercury Music Prize.
Even now, you see them doing, like, Newborn, and you just look and you think, this is really staggering, but it was staggering when it came out 10 years ago. Trench conventions.
Complex, innovative compositions like Little Beast revealed Guy Garvey's uneasy relationship with his hometown of Bury in Lancashire. Times When these songs came out, what did people in Bury think? They think you were letting them down or betraying them, or...?
Certain people did, but certain people agreed with me as well. I mean, it's in such a beautiful part of the world. Mm. You drive 2 minutes and you're in the most lovely countryside, and it's got a strong, positive history to the place. Plenty to be proud of, but at that time, it was the general sacking of the north of England during Margaret Thatcher's reign. It was just... She did her best to pull apart community in the north. I was sort of the first generation to grow up in it. Some of the lyrics of Little Beast, all of the lyrics of Little Beast, are describing how it feels to be one of those people. You get out into the hills, and it struck me one day as I was driving to Cone, where my mother grew up, that there was a main street coming off the hill with little cul-de-sacs of terraced houses, and it actually looked like a spine going over the hill. And I wrote it into Little Beast, the whole town's dripping down the hill like the spine of something dead. And it goes into the mentality of somebody. The chorus is, fear is not respect, correct, but it's the best you're going to get. I honestly believe that going out and terrorising people to get their fear is the closest thing that you can get to respect sometimes. If you can't get people's respect because there's not necessarily anything you can do that you would be proud of, you'll settle for their fear. And I think that's a lot of the young men that I grew up around. But not me.
After the Seldom Seen Kid did really well last year and won lots of awards, we were granted the freedom of Bury, along with film director Danny Boyle. And it was a really lovely sort of family day, going and picking up a certificate and a medal and being appreciated by the borough after not always being that complimentary about the place.
I don't think Bury was half as bad as we made out, or as Guy made out, calling it a shithole that time. You know, we turned all right, turned out all right. We still live round here. I'm quite happy to bring my kids up round here. I think it's good. It's close to Manchester, the best city in the world. What more do you want? I didn't really have a problem with it at all. Guy had a problem with the world. Guy was a 17-year-old stroppy frontman. He had a problem with everything.
It's amazing, really, that five blokes from a mill town with no mills, where, you know, traditionally you are blokey, and you do go to the pub and you do go to football. Amazing that the five of us found each other and started writing this earnest romantic music, because it's something perhaps I wouldn't share with somebody else if I hadn't met them and known it was okay to do so. Yes, I live off the mirrors and smoke. It's a joke, a fix. This is something my mum said. My mum said she thought I was allowing blokey blokes somewhere to go and be upset or be in love, be emotional. Very proud of that, if that's the case, you know. The Boosters told gentle boy to a terrible totem.
Kids gather round trying to see what's inside. I think when he's drinking, he's drowning some riots. What is my friend trying to hide?
I know the music that the boys write, I find incredibly stirring. The attention to the details and the moves are always to evoke emotion. The things that the five of us find beautiful in music, the common ground, the stuff we write, it's because all the other four tick in a similar way to I do.
The view is of Strange Ways Prison, which is very nice. You would have seen them on the roof there, whenever that was.
Craig Potter's the youngest member of Elbow. He was still at school when he joined the band to play keyboards. He's now the band's producer.
We recorded quite a lot of the Seldom Seen Kid in here. Some vocals were often done here in the stairwell. This is quite a nice place for recording drums. Sometimes I prefer it to the big room we've got. Yeah. And we used to hit that there. That's I think that's on Audience with the Pope, actually, as one of the percussion parts. The classic radiator scrape. Yeah, we've always experimented with sound. We've never really been the band that, members of the band say, no, I'm the keyboard player, so I will. Where's the keyboards on this song? Or, you know, I'm the guitar player, and there needs to be, well, I haven't played guitar yet. And it's like, it's not necessarily, it's all about what's right for the song. And quite often someone comes up with an idea for a sound, and it's like, right, let's go out and try and find it, you know, somewhere. It doesn't have to be on instruments or even on an instrument, you know. So, for example, here's I've got Weather to Fly up here. That's Jupp crouched on the floor, hitting the sustain pedal on the piano as hard as he could, so the strings reverberate, and then he lets go, and it just goes. It's similar to an old effect that they used to use in horror films, where you put your sustain pedal down and you smash all the hammers against the strings, and it goes. It's similar to that, and we sort of adapted it slightly and used it on Weather to Fly. This is the beat, basically, for the majority of the song. And when the horns come in at the end, then there's more of a normal drum beat comes in.
Anybody can start a song, anybody can play any instrument at any time, anybody can tell anybody else in the band what they like and don't like about what they're doing, and regularly a decision will go to the vote. And that's the same with my lyrics.
Can you point yourself to any specific influences writing lyrics?
I love all the great lyricists, really. So Joni Mitchell and Leonard Cohen and Bob Dylan being three of the best ever. Lyrically, I'd say Joni Mitchell was probably the biggest influence.
What qualities does she have that you're impressed by?
A very natural, conversational sort of style in a lot of her best songs. There's an earnest quality to her lyrics that's almost embarrassing, you know. She'll come out with something so personal and so unmistakably true that you're actually quite embarrassed to listen to it sometimes. She won't write a black and white love song. She'll say, I hate you and I love you all at the same time, and convincingly complex emotions put in a really believable way. I think that's the holy grail of lyric writing. I leaned on you today. I regularly heard but never say. Patch me up and send me on my way. I leaned on you today.
Taking in simple piano and vocal, orchestral arrangements and experimental noise, Elbow feel their albums are single bodies of work, not collections of songs. The scope of their albums is reminiscent of the later works of the 1980s group Talk Talk.
There's things on Laughingstock, it's on After the Flood. It's like a guitar amp that's been left in a room. Feedback been going on. It's like it's been going on for days. It sounds that messed up that, and it just comes in out of nowhere and just stays for much longer than you think it's gonna. There's influence like on songs like I've Got Your Number. There's like an organ solo, although we don't do too many solos, where it's just like an organ solo that just sticks out of, it comes from nowhere. It's like, it's almost like it's quite shocking, which we like to do a lot.
Like their albums that, you know, like there's like a lot of space in there. There's a lot of, you know, it's not about cramming as much as you can into it. It's about letting it just like grow and, you know, and where you don't need a bass or a guitar or whatever, just don't have it. If you don't need drums, don't use them. You don't have to use those things.
We heard a story about there's a guy, one of the record company guys, came to the studio after they'd finished it, and apparently he just sat there and when it was over he just started crying. and they weren't sure whether he was crying because it was so beautiful or whether it was because there's absolutely no singles on it and they weren't going to make any money. And we sort of like quite warmed to that story because I think we quite like the idea of doing stuff like that.
There's a song called Friend of Ours on the Seldom Seen Kid, which is a song about our mate Brian that we lost during the making of the record. And it's a very simple acoustic number, really. And the biggest movement in it comes midway through the song, and it's sweeping strings. And that sort of, from almost nothing to sweeping crescendo and then back to nothing, definitely came from the Talk Talk influence.
never very good at goodbyes. So gentle, shoulder charge, love he made.
It's a very, very personal song that requires a full orchestra in order to perform it and do it justice. And that was the first opportunity we'd had. So we absolutely loved that. We'd never played it live before.
The song ends with "Love You Mate," which is how Brian ended all phone calls with all his friends. So, because he always ended his phone calls that way, I know that's the last thing he said to me. But somebody mentioned that they'd never really heard it in a song before, sort of that, yeah, blokes loving each other. But, you know, of course you do, of course you love your mates.
Elbow's third album, Leaders of the Free World, was released with a series of animated films by video artist Soup Collective, which premiered at the National Film Theatre. It was also the first time Guy Garvey used Elbow's music to reflect his political views. Has there been any sort of agenda about putting your opinions into your songs, your political opinions?
I write about my opinions and I feel very strongly about them, and I write them down in my books, but they don't always make song. Part of the reason for that is I'm one of five people. And they don't always want the songs to be about my opinions and how strongly I feel about them.
What about Leaders of the Free World?
Making that the title of the album was a conscious effort to show what we thought of the current state of world politics without making an album about that. I've often thought that outrage doesn't seem to work anymore. Public outrage and protest doesn't seem to work in this country. So I was trying something new. Ridicule, subtle ridicule.
The lyrics to Leaders of the Free World don't present a direct agenda, more a yearning for justice to prevail. Periscope up, demands Garvey. I need to see the Commander-in-Chief and remind him what was passed on to you and me.
Think it isn't driven. Like
we've written much more pointed stuff than that. Snowball was quite a pointed one. Well, the chorus was that the biggest of mistakes can be forgiven, but a snowball of little white lies will crush your house. And at the end of it, it actually pictures Tony Blair in a bath chair at the age of 102. And it wishes the souls of the millions of people that he's responsible for killing, visiting him for eternity, which is pretty dark. I was pretty angry when I wrote that. I'm not as angry as I was generally about things. I still get annoyed, but it's more like a dull worry as I'm approaching 40. You know, like when I was a kid, I could get proper fired up and angry about things that concern me about anything, sociological, anything. I wrote it down like this. There's a laddered tear in my high ideals, like I took a chair on the battlefield, and the noble fire that was in my chest is acid in my belly at the very best.
Guy was the sort of person who I could always imagine as being my Labour MP. And when I, you know, when I say Labour, as you can probably imagine, I mean in sort of like the more idealistic sense of Labour.
We are revolutionary. We sing about the truth.
Met up with these Cuban rappers and they taped them doing their thing in the street and it was really impressive.
Tentado por Satanás, ambición y nada. Cualquiera puede matar por el maldito crap. No.
After about 5 minutes of walking, they got pulled by the police. They asked them to see their ID. And they ended up getting put in a police van and taken away.
People would say, look, if you want to go to America, don't go to Cuba first, because A, the passport might be tricky, and B, there are various people in that sort of area in America who think Cuba bad, don't let these Reds into America. Did that ever occur to you before you went to Cuba?
Yeah, it was a real concern. People go to extraordinary lengths not to upset America, because it's seen as the next logical step after you've succeeded in this country. So it was a concern, but not one that I took seriously. At that time, the propaganda was that every third person was a government informant. And after seeing these guys that we met on the street who were speaking their minds freely through rapping, they were all these hip-hop guys, they were disappeared pretty much in front of us for what they were saying. So it was quite scary, actually. It was also incredibly beautiful.
I started this series about 30-odd years ago. We started with Paul McCartney, and the last group we're doing is you and yourself. It's all the way, from Liverpool to Manchester. But what's the journey, do you think, the sort of music you're interested in has taken over that period?
Well, Paul McCartney being a key player, the Beatles being really important, especially to us. The way they started using studio production as part of the art form, the way that their records were about the recording rather than about the song. There was other people doing it, but they really brought it forward. We wouldn't make the music we make if the recording process wasn't one of the artistic tools that we had. It was good that we saw some of the old world, where albums cost £500,000 to £1 million to make. It's great that we sort of came up in that period, but it's also great to be part of this new thing where, with a computer and a small room in Salford, we can make a record that can reach so many people.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.